Democrats gaining momentum, that as we inch closer to the midterm elections. Congressman Joe Crowley joins me to talk about that, President Trump, and much more. Also, during an unbelievably rambling interview on Fox and Friends, President Trump admits Michael Cohen represented him on the Stormy Daniels deal. That's a complete 180 to what he had said before, and it has legal implications. We'll take a close look at how this whole thing could impact the President of the United States. Then EPA head Scott Pruitt, he got lambasted by Congress for ethics, spending, and more. But the question is, will this matter in the end, or will he still keep his job? Evening, everyone, and welcome to RFL. I'm Richard French, and thank you for joining me this Thursday evening. President Trump appearing on his favorite show this morning, Fox and Friends, and he sure seemed comfortable and confident. He even graded himself.
I would give myself an A+. Nobody has done what I've been able to do, and I did it despite the fact that I have a phony cloud over my head that doesn't exist. It was what the Democrats used to try and make an excuse for their loss of an election, for their loss of the Electoral College that they should never lose.
Okay, sounds like certainly the man is grading on a curve, but he also went way off script, unloading on the FBI, the nation's top law enforcement agency. Here he is again.
You look at the corruption at the top of the FBI, it's a disgrace. And our Justice Department, which I try and stay away from, but at some point I won't. Our Justice Department should be looking at that kind of stuff, not the nonsense of collusion with Russia. There is no collusion with me and Russia.
The President of the United States screaming into the phone on a live phone interview with Fox. And look at those hosts. They look like they were in a hostage video. Anyway, just another day at the White House, and you cannot make this up. The President gave a 30-minute phone interview on Fox, and his pick to run the VA here, Dr. Ronnie Jackson, that same morning withdrew under obviously that cloud of misconduct allegations. Dr. Jackson, though, apparently remain on as the White House physician. His EPA chief, Scott Pruitt, on Capitol Hill for a budget hearing, he gets slammed over spending on things like a $43,000 phone booth, first-class travel with pricey security detail, and more. Then the president's HUD secretary, Ben Carson, says he wants to raise the rent on elderly, the poor, and the disabled living in subsidized housing. Unbelievable. Now, this is what passes as, I guess, normalcy in a White House. And I didn't even get into how the whole Cohen investigation got even more confused and even potentially very problematic for not just Mr. Cohen, but also the president. Now, I spoke to Joe Crowley earlier today to talk about that. He, a Democrat from New York, also chairman of the Democratic caucus. You know, Congressman, another day, another unbelievable fire hose of insanity coming out of D.C. I guess that's where I'll start. It's impossible to cover all these headlines, but has the day-to-day really craziness, has that become normalized on the Hill? I'm curious, do you guys look at each other, Republican and Democrat alike, and shake your head?
It has become all too often part of the norm here, whether we're here in Washington or back home in our districts, what the latest tweet of the day is. And it certainly has, I think, in many respects, transformed the nature of politics in the country. But the level of tolerance for the absurd has certainly increased as well here in Washington, and that may be, that may very well be a dangerous thing.
I want to get to one thing that's getting lost, one of many things that got lost in some of the coverage. A former colleague of yours, Mick Mulvaney, now the interim budget director, used to be at the Citizens Financial Protection Bureau. He talked to a bunch of bankers, and he said the following. In my time in Congress, he was speaking of, if you're a lobbyist who never gave us money, I don't talk to you. If you're a lobbyist who gave me money, I might talk to you. Is that the reality of Washington, or does this guy not speak for you?
Never happens in my office, quite frankly. That's utter ridiculous talk, and I think maybe reflective of how he conducted himself, which I think is reprehensible if that is the case. And it's not the way in which my office operates. I think it's sinful and disgusting if that's the way in which he viewed it or how his office was operating. It just is just disgusting, to say the least.
And just to let everybody know, he told those same group of bankers that he wants to shut down a database where the public can lodge complaints against financial companies. They've stopped doing all investigations in open cases right now and won't open new ones. I mean, that's unbelievable. We're not talking about this, but if the public after 2008 thinks they have the government on their side, they're sadly mistaken.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the greatest achievements in the Dodd-Frank legislation following the collapse of the markets in 2008, after the passage of TARP, after, you know, the bailing out of the big banks and really saving them from utter collapse, you know, the general public was out there, what about us? And what the Congress created was the CFPB, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. And it was there to really protect the consumers, to be there for an outlet for the consumers. You know, who was watching their back? Who was making sure these financial institutions were accountable? And it is and was the CFPB until Mick Mulvaney got his second job in the White House, and which, again, it really crosses over all norms of government operation for him to be the budget director as well as the head of the CFPB. But again, as I said earlier, it seems the playbook has been thrown out the window.
Another piece of news that, again, gets lost in the coverage. You got a lot of public housing in your district. Ben Carson, the head of HUD, wants to raise rents on the poor, the elderly, and the disabled. You can't make this up if you try.
Yeah. Now, it shows you how out of touch Ben Carson is in this job. You know, for someone who's had such an illustrious career as a surgeon, to now, in many respects, I think, end his career as really the top person for housing in the United States and not know what he's talking about or have any understanding or empathy for the people who live in public housing. The notion or idea of raising their rents threefold is utterly and absolutely crazy. But again, as you know, you started off this interview talking about what's coming out of Washington, coming out of this administration. And it's become the norm. They say the most obnoxious and many times the most obscene things. And I put this in the obscene category. We're talking about people who are trying to make ends meet, who are trying to survive in no small way. We know the condition of public housing, certainly in New York and around the country, is less than adequate. And the notion or idea of raising their rents, again, it's like the same notion, Richard, about food stamps and the SNAP program, requiring work hours. All it's going to do is hurt children and older people, quite frankly. And the same people get hurt here if they ever try to attempt to raise the rents of public housing threefold. It'll be the poor, it'll be children, and the elderly are hurt the most.
Fine, before I let you go, your old buddy Steve Israel and I talked a little while ago on the air, and he said Joe Crowley would be a great speaker. My question is, Nancy Pelosi's name is what they're going to use on the campaign trail. Why wouldn't it be in Democrats' best interest to have a new leader, you, before the November midterms? Why take that arrow out of their quiver besides you guys getting beaten up with it on the campaign between now and November?
Well, look, Richard, I appreciate it, and I'm honored that some would suggest that I be in that position. Let me just say this. We are all focused on winning the House first. That's the most important thing, and not to be bogged down into distractions. I think, quite frankly, the Republicans are distracted right now with Mr. Ryan's announcement that he's leaving, and they're a bit of disheveled over that. And we don't need that in our caucus right now. We have Leader Pelosi, and I think what this is really coming from is the Republicans being bankrupt with ideas. They have no ideas to move the American people forward, and they fall back on this old playbook, and it's old, it's haggard, and we need to move on from that.
Congressman, I appreciate the time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Richard.
Coming up next, President Trump's stunning admission about Stormy Daniels and his attorney, Michael Cohen. Former federal prosecutor Roland Riopelle, he joins us next to discuss just how high the stakes are and how big a development all this was.